our battles, and every knee will bow before Him. And our God is the Lamb that was slain for the sins of the world. His blood breaks the chains, and every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. And every knee will bow before.
Yeah. There we go, perfect timing. Good morning, everybody. Good morning, they all cried, as did those who are joining us online as well, so great welcome. I'm really glad you're here, and I'm glad to be here. Some of you don't know me, you're the fortunate ones, but that's a really good positive thing. I'm Martin Kirkbride, but actually I've been part of this church for 5 years now. But the reason you don't see me around or only occasionally is that most of my commitment is as a locum covering other parishes and ministry with military veterans. And even when I am here, I often leave a little bit early. So if things don't go well today, I'll sort of say I have another commitment and leave early. But actually, I'm planning on staying. I love being here at St. G's. It's my home church. And I'm absolutely blessed by the superb ministry of Nick, Rob and Richard and the entire team. The worship is absolutely inspirational. And as I often, even though I'm not here, often when I get back on a Sunday, I follow the service here online. I'm really appreciative to the work done by Matt and the tech team. Okay, all those people mentioned now owe me a fiver. Right, the notices. Encouragement about the community fridge. I've been looking at the community fridge quite often when I'm parking the car, and I now know where bananas go to die. In their hordes, but there are loads of them. But the main notices, there's prayer here tonight at 7 o'clock. Do make that a priority if you can. There's nothing good on telly. Antiques Roadshow or prayer, which do you prefer? Yes, I thought you would. Nick is having a well-earned rest, but Nick and the office will be back this week. The main activities and Rob, your curate, will be back the following week. Okay, last week, Easter Sunday, we celebrated the empty tomb and the resurrection with the Easter acclamation to the proclamation, Christ is risen, and you all responded, he is risen indeed, hallelujah. Now, randomly, just to check that you're still engaged, randomly, throughout this morning's service, I might just throw that in. A, because it's a wonderful acclamation, and B, because it checks that you're not absolutely worn out and zoned out by the half-term break. You can make as much noise as you want. The children are staying in today, as are the young people. They can make as much noise as they want. They can run around if they want. This is an Anglican church, and all signs of life are very appreciated. Okay, Christ is risen. Let's pray. Risen Lord, for whom no door is locked, no entrance barred, open the doors of our hearts. Open our hearts, minds, and lives to worship you in spirit and in truth. Open our hearts, minds, and lives to know your love and to live in your love. Amen. Amen. Would you please stand? Christ is risen. Let's worship.
You do not fade, you are. Yeah.
That's where we want to be, Lord, in your presence, gathered here. Amen. Would you please be seated for our reading? Kids, you can continue to do whatever kids do, but if you want an activity bag, there are some activity bags at the back of church somewhere. Whereabouts are they? Can you wave where the activity bags are? Activity bags are over there. And adults, no, you can't have an activity bag. Thank you.
Okay. Our reading today is taken from the Gospel of John, Chapter 20, from verse 19 to the end. On the evening of that day, the first day of the week, the doors being locked where the disciples were for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." When he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, even so I am sending you." And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you withhold forgiveness from any, it is withheld." Now Thomas, one of the 12, called the twin, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see in his hands the mark of the nails, and place my finger into the mark of the nails, and place my hand into his side, I will never believe." 8 days later, his disciples were inside again, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands, and put out your hand and place it in my side. Do not disbelieve, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of the disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. You pray for me, please. Thank you.
Lord, I thank you so much for Martin and bringing him here with us today. I pray that as he opens your word before us, I pray that he'd be anointed and would hear from you, and as he teaches, that our hearts would be open and our minds alert to what you are teaching us through his word today. So I pray your blessing on him now in your precious name, Lord Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. Thank you. Oh, wow. It's at this point that Nick and Rob always ask a question. That really annoys me because they ask really good questions, and I'm not good at asking really good questions. So to compensate this morning, I'm going to ask two questions. Two mediocre questions will compensate for one good question. But actually, what I want to ask the two questions is, this side of the church, that's you and you, everyone on this side of the church, your question is, what is one of your best or happiest days? Okay? No one moved places, by the way. And this side of the church, your question is, what is one of your worst or saddest days? Okay, now if you'd rather be on one side and answer the question, I'm sorry you can't. So this side of the church, you have 2 minutes to chat to someone next to you. What is one of your best or happiest days? Oh, by the way, before you start, I know that in church the answer is always Jesus. Look, for this question, we're not counting Jesus in. And the second thing is, you may want to say it's the day of your wedding or your engagement. That's a given, so even that's your best or happiest day, no weddings or engagements. And if it's your worst or sad day, we don't want it either. So, 2 minutes, thank you. Okay, how are we doing? Right. You have 10 more seconds if you want to make some great revelation. Okay, no great revelations. Right, this very happy side of the church. Who wants to share what was a very special, happy, joyful day? Surely someone had one. We could be here a long time. Yes, please, hang on. Way, happy anniversary. Okay, can we have a non-wedding day now, please? Children?
The birth of my first child.
The birth of your first child, new life, wonderful. Okay. Oh, right. I don't normally run this far.
I'm afraid it is a wedding day. Sort of, but the contrast with the day before, when I lost the certificate that you need as I was clearing out my room, and then I was late. We were meeting up in the afternoon. I missed the date. I would never miss the date all the time we were going out.
Okay.
So it was a bad day, but contrast with the phone.
You can sit in the middle. Right. Okay. I hate the way Nick runs and doesn't get out of breath. Okay. Sad, worst days this side. Oh, come on, Sam, that's great.
It was the day that the business I was working for collapsed.
When?
The day the business I worked for collapsed.
Okay.
A couple of years ago. So it wasn't, yeah, wasn't a good day.
That's not good, the end of something. Anyone else on this side?
We've got quite a few deaths, yeah.
Quite a few deaths, okay. That's good. Good job you're on this side of the church, not that side. Okay, we have something here, yes. What are you guys going to tell us?
My worst day was the day that I tripped on the stairs and I hit my head a lot of times. I was skipped a prayer that day.
Okay. Oh. No, that's... How's your head now? Okay. And did you find which one of your brothers or sisters pushed you? Yeah. Okay, wonderful. So we have lots of examples there. Happy days, something special. Worst days, something not special. When things go wrong. When people die. Okay, today's reading, let's catch the breath. Today's reading has its backstory in the awful sadness of Good Friday, the worst of crucifixions, the death of Jesus. And now we move on, because following the empty tomb, we have the joy of the encounters with the risen Lord. Christ is risen? Just checking. Wonderful, thank you. So it's on that evening of the first resurrection day. The disciples are all together in a locked room when Jesus comes and stands amongst them. It says that the door was locked for fears of the Jews. It sounds a bit uncomfortable. This is not an anti-Semitic statement, because actually the majority of those inside the locked room are also Jewish. So by fear of the Jews, that's John's shorthand for the Jewish leaders, the priests, the Pharisees, the temple officials, those who would persecute and arrest. And a locked room. If you think about it for a moment, isn't it common for many of us that when we're faced with a trauma, with a sadness, an emotional despair, or guilt, that we have a human tendency to lock ourselves away? And in this situation, that locked room has got something to say to each one of us. And I want to explore that more, so I'm going to explore that in this week's edition of An Extra Slice. And so Jesus comes into this locked room and he greets them with a very standard Hebrew salutation. Shalom halakhem, shalom, peace, halakhem, shalom halakhem. And this isn't just the traditional everyday greeting. In this instance, it's more, because it's the literal fulfilling of what Jesus had promised them back in John chapter 14, verse 27, when he says, shalom halakhem, peace I leave you, my peace I give you. And my peace is not the world's peace, so do not let your hearts be troubled and do not be afraid. Jesus is reiterating something that he's already said. This is a very special greeting, my peace. But this Hebrew greeting of peace is a blessing. Now, in the East, not just in Judaism, but in nearly all Eastern cultures, a greeting is always in the form of a blessing. Very different from our Western culture, where greetings are usually in the form of a question or a statement. And the question in various ways revolves around, how are you? How do you do? How are things? We meet people and we ask them a question. And usually, we don't particularly want a detailed answer. You know, if I ask you how you are, just say fine, please. That is quite sufficient. You know, I come from the north, where you used to ask the men, you know, how are you? And they would say, well, mustn't grumble. Oh, what a lie. That, you know, that's what, mustn't grumble. They never shut up for the next 10 minutes. So usually we don't want an answer. Or alternatively, we can just default to a very standard hi. Of course, you don't need an answer to that, do you? But there's an important point here, because of all the options, if you think about it, I prefer the option that is a blessing salutation, that we meet people with a blessing. And for me, especially the biblical one taken from the opening verses of Jude, mercy, peace, and love be yours in abundance. Now, I'd probably sound a bit churchy if I bump into you in sort of the Ivory Park and say, good morning, mercy, peace, and love be yours in abundance. But actually, does that say more than hi? Or how are you? So there's that wonderful greeting. A greeting in some way should be a blessing. Now, let's not change our culture, but let's ensure that when we encounter people, we make it a blessing. Anyway, end of digression. The worst day of crucifixion and the death has now transitioned into the best day of the resurrection and new life. Christ is risen. Wonderful, you're still with me. So having greeted them, Jesus literally breathes out the Holy Spirit upon them and says something that to our initial hearing, he then says something which is quite puzzling. Because having proclaimed the Holy Spirit, he says to the disciples, if you forgive anyone's sins, their sins are forgiven, and if you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven. Ooh. But you see, this isn't about making the disciples the arbiters of sin, giving them some sort of executive power to be the dispensers of forgiveness or the withholders of forgiveness. We have to better understand this statement in its context within the mission of the disciples. John has already said to the disciples, I am sending you, apostelos, you're the apostles, I am sending you. And actually, when he says, I am sending you, the context of this verse on forgiveness is actually missional. They are sent out to share the gospel, a gospel of the forgiveness which is found in new life in Christ. And if they don't go out and proclaim that availability of forgiveness, then how many people will remain outside of that forgiveness because they don't know of that forgiveness, they don't know of that good news? It was the Apostle Paul, he reflects something of this in Romans chapter 10. I'm going to read it from the message, but this context it. When Paul writes, but how can people call for help if they don't know who to trust? And how can they know to trust if they haven't heard of the one who can be trusted? And how can they hear if nobody tells them? And how is anyone going to tell them unless someone is sent to do it? Basically, John is writing here to the disciples, to followers of Christ, if you don't go out and tell them about Christ and the forgiveness that is included in that, how are people to be forgiven? How are they to know it? But anyway, I want to pick up on that as the second tranche sort of thing in this week's extra slice, not just on how John is contexting this link between mission and forgiveness, but I want to just spend a few minutes midweek delving into this actual word forgiveness, what it actually means and what it does. So I need to move on from that because we come to doubting Thomas. Oh, doubting Thomas. Do you know something? I do not like hearing him referred to as doubting Thomas. That soubriquet is an historical injustice. If you think about it, not having been present when the risen Jesus appeared, he's actually only asking for what the other disciples have already had. They have seen for themselves. And Thomas says, I want to see for myself. And he has the bravery, he has the integrity to ask questions and to explore the answers. He wants to explore this. Because faith, true faith, is not secured second hand. And faith doesn't avoid questions or struggles of disbelief. The courage to explore issues is one that can lead us to faith. It builds up our faith. So Thomas is the one who has the bravery to ask hard questions and to personally interact with exploring the truth. And that process is biblical. You know, I've been around for a long time. I've read my Bible through, and through. And I have to tell you, I cannot find a single verse in the Old or the New Testament that says, throw away your brain and be a mindless automaton for Jesus. The Bible actually encourages, and in fact, the whole of the Old Testament is the story of people struggling with disbelief and trying to find faith, a real faith. And what comes to mind for this is John, for me, is always John chapter 14 when I think about Thomas. Because if we go back to John chapter 14, Jesus tells his disciples that he's going away and that he's going to prepare a place for them. And when he comes back, he will take them to that place. And they know the way to that place where he is going. And when Jesus is saying this, all the other disciples have stood around and they're nodding very wisely. Yes. And inwardly they're thinking, what is he talking about? Haven't got a clue. They don't actually understand, but have you ever sort of been in a conversation where you haven't a clue what someone's talking about and you nod wisely anyway? It can get you into an awful lot of trouble. Many years ago, I was in the British Museum and they'd arranged for a group of us to actually be taken on a tour of the British Museum, but actually underneath in the vaults where there were lots of things. And knowing that we're theology students, there's a very wise professor, archivist there, took us and she took us to a lot of stone slabs and started talking about the cuneiform on them. And I do wish someone had said in the first minute that actually most of us actually can't read cuneiform or whatever. So an hour later, we're all nodding very wisely and I haven't a clue to this day what she was talking about. I just wish I or someone had had the bravery to, and this is what Thomas does. Thomas, all the others are saying, oh yes, and not a clue. And Thomas is the only one who has the integrity and the honour to say, Lord, I haven't got a clue what you're talking about. I do not know what you mean. I do not know this place. And I do not know how to get there. And you know something? Forget doubting Thomas. Thank God for Thomas. Because it's Thomas's question at that stage that elicits the answer that they and everyone needed to know, that everyone still needs to know. That's Jesus' response to his question. And Jesus said, I am the way. I am the way, the truth, and the life. Without that, gosh, what a struggle we'd find to go through the gospel. In my first parish, it was only on my first week, and I'd arranged to see the second most important person in the entire church, and that was the treasurer. And the treasurer, who was an accountant, had an office in the city centre. So I would meet him at a certain time. So off I went. Now, Lancaster is a very small city with a very complicated one-way system. So I went to find his office. And I'm driving round, and I know where the street is, but I can't seem to get in it because it has a no entry and buses only. And I'm spinning. Well, I went round the one-way system three times trying to find a legal way to get to where his office was. In the end, I gave up, and I pulled up. This rather dates it, but I pulled up, and alongside on the road was a mature gentleman walking along with his stout walking stick with a copy of a paper underneath his arm sort of thing, and he had a flat cap on, true northerner. So I pulled up, and I said, excuse me, can you tell me how I get into, and I asked the way into Brock Street. Oh, my word, he told me the way in great detail how I would get there. Even when I passed that shop there, Ethel used to work there and this, that and the other. And then the most annoying bit, he picked up his stick and pointed in the general direction. So I got in the car. Well, whether Ethel worked in that corner shop, I do not know. But you know something? I was totally lost. I went round the one-way system again. I came round the one-way system. I saw someone else and I pulled over and I asked them for directions in how I could access legally driving into Brock Street. And the chap started to tell me. And then he sort of looked and he said, hang on. Once again, true northerner, sorry about my friends in the north. He pulled out an old envelope from his pocket and got a pen out and did me a little diagram. Fantastic, I thought, a diagram that is just what I need. I propped this little diagram on the back of an envelope on my dashboard and off I set. Have you ever tried reading a screwed up envelope while you're sort of trying to maneuver around a city centre? Totally lost. Third time, pulled up. And I asked someone who was just walking towards the multi-story car park, and I saw, and he saw the look of absolute dismay on my face. And he said to me, he said, oh, hang on a minute, he said, I'm just leaving the car park. This is what dates it. He said, I'm in a blue Escort. He said, when I come out, he said, I'll flash my lights. He said, tuck right in behind me. He said, we'll go in the first lane. He said, and just before your turn off, I'll move into the second lane. He said, when I flash my indicators again, you're going to turn right. Do you know something? It was wonderful. Out came this blue Escort. I tucked in behind him, wait for it, in my Ford Cortina. Loved it. And we moved along, and then he indicated to turn for me to turn right after we'd crossed the lanes. And I thought, but it still says no entry buses. But it was only as I moved into that lane, I saw that there was actually a little bit that veered off and came back round where you could enter. Do you know something? It was a piece of cake. It is so easy to follow someone. Hold on to that, because that's something we're going to finish with. Okay, not just a digression. Now, the path of the gospel, the journey of personal faith, is bound in following. Following Christ. So, now, let me, after all that, let me get back to the text and bring this into land. Christ is risen. Wonderful. Now, faced with the truth and finding himself in an encounter with the living Lord, Thomas only has one response, his acknowledgement, my Lord and my God. My Lord and my God. And that is where I want to land this. That touchdown challenge is this statement a reflection of your own life? Does it describe your faith? Is it a statement of a personal relationship, your statement of a personal relationship with Jesus Christ? My Lord and my God. And John tells us in closing his gospel that these things are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. Life in his name. Do you know what has always encouraged me? Jesus didn't just tell us the way. He didn't point a stick in the general direction. And Jesus didn't just write things down for us, what we might call back of an envelope theology. Jesus simply said, follow me. Anyone can follow. It's so easy to follow. The actual following itself might bring hardships, but the process of following, it's one of the first things children do, isn't it? A children's game, following. Would you like to stand, please? I'm going to pray about following Christ. Anyone can follow. Jesus breathed his Holy Spirit upon them. And Lord, would you breathe your Holy Spirit upon us anew this morning? That those of us who have been following you for some time may be renewed in the joy and the integrity and the passion of that following. And those of us perhaps who may not have followed you or have broken off in that journey of faith of following you. Lord, the Lord to whom no door is locked, no room is barred. Lord, would you enter hearts this morning, bringing that commitment to following you as Lord and God, as Christ and Saviour, as the one who forgives our sins, gives us new life, and sets us on our way. Not alone, but in the power of his Holy Spirit, in the sustenance of his word, in the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, and in the fellowship of each other, we pray, come Lord Jesus, come Holy Spirit, come Spirit of God, encourage us in our walk with you, lead us in our walk with you. And all of God's people said, Amen. Amen. Would you like to sit as we continue in prayer, please?
Good morning. Morning, onliners. Christ is risen. Yeah. And in that truth, I would ask a question to start our prayers. Am I alone in thinking that we need to pray for more truthfulness in this world. Yes, goodo. So let's pray together this morning for a miracle. I'll set a prayerful scene. Lord God in heaven, in the days surrounding Jesus' death and resurrection, the disciples didn't know what or who to believe. A betrayal of friendship by at least one of their own was enough to shake their confidence in who or what to trust going forward. But then Mary returns from the tomb with, quite frankly, a far-fetched tale, after which a virtually real man, whom they had recently buried, enters a closed room without using the door. And of course, then came the call from Thomas for proof, a need for evidence on which to base his trust. Lord, the first disciples tried to understand what was happening in their reality. You might have heard quite a few of us lately looking heavenwards and asking, what the heck is going on, Lord? What is happening in our world, in our lives, and in our differing realities? Who and what can we believe? And with an echo of Pontius Pilate, perhaps we might even be asking, what is truth? We know, Lord, that Jesus was born into this world to testify and to witness to the truth. But you have raised us to be witnesses until he comes again in glory. So, Almighty God, would you equip us? Would you fill us with courage, protect us and sustain us as we stand firm in our knowledge and witness to the truth? Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, if we hold to your teaching, then we will know the truth, and the truth will set us free. Help us in our scripture reading habits. If we are stuck, then guide us towards the Bible notes and the activities which will release in us what you have placed there. Lord, in a time of information overload, distraction, fake news, artificial voices, all sorts of media and advertising, please strengthen our resolve to study, to pray, to worship, to hold on to your word. Release us from temptations to be led astray, to be self-absorbed and self-indulgent and vain. Ignite in us that precious fruit of your Holy Spirit, self-control. We confess to you now our thoughts, actions, and omissions, Lord, which this past week have not been an honest and true witness. May we receive your forgiveness and may the truth set us free. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord God, at the request of Jesus, you sent to us a counselor, the Spirit of Truth, to remind us of what Jesus said and demonstrated during his life. So, in the presence of this holy counselor, one who will listen, one who will aid our understanding, one who will help us to move or change our thinking and behavior, we pray a very big prayer. That with the belt of truth buckled around our waists, your disciples in this church and throughout the world will be renewed in their Christian lives, be revived in their witness to the truth, in homes and workplaces, in relationships, in shops and playgrounds, in industry and politics, commerce and banking, in agencies of governance and judgment, in sport, in laboratories, in boardrooms and classrooms, in journalism, in our own postings and chats and conversations. Lord, we pray for truth and integrity in science and technology, We are thankful, so thankful that so many positive capabilities exist. But keep us grounded in your reality, Lord, your truth. May progress in artificial intelligence and virtual reality be protected against those who would want to use it to abuse others. Preserve and protect all of us from becoming victims of dishonesty and scams. Keep us standing firm. Keep us alert to deception. Give us courage and grace when falsehood needs to be challenged in ourselves and others. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And finally, we pray very specifically in this moment for individuals and institutions who, as we pray and worship in this place, are elsewhere using keyboards for trolling or constructing harmful content for online platforms, who are seeking to exploit or influence others into dangerous activity, who seek to distort the truth and spread information which they know will cause anxiety, confusion, and instability in a population. In this moment, by the power of your Spirit of Truth, transform mischief into honesty, cruelty into kindness, criticism into a desire to hear something good, the good news, the gospel of our Lord. If you repeat a few lines after me, strength in this prayer in the power of the Spirit. Appear to them, Lord Jesus. Appear to them, Lord Jesus. Stand in their line of sight. Stand in their line of sight. Show them the wounds in your hands and feet. Show them the wounds in your hands and feet. Bring them into your transforming light. Bring them into your transforming light. Amen. Almighty and ever-living Father, turn our hearts and minds to whatever is true, whatever is right, and may we all think about these things. As we leave this place, Lord, stay with us. As our children and young people return to school and college, stay with them. And may we all stand firm in the truth that Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. And we thank you, Lord. Amen.
Amen. Why don't we stand and worship?
There's no prison wall you can't break through. No mountain you can't move. All things are possible. There's no broken body you can raise. No soul that you can save. All things are possible. 'Cause there's no prison. Great.
Thank you.
Friends, please don't rush off, but when you do go, take the love, the peace, and the blessing of this place with you. Take the children as well, by the way. But I just want to remind us at prayer tonight, but there's prayer available this morning, which I think is over in that far corner of the church, so if you like prayer, do grab some prayer. If you have identified with that issue of distress or despair or dejection or guilt, that sort of locked room syndrome, do please join us online midweek when we're going to unpack that. But I do have prayer for that today. And we're going to look at this whole business of forgiveness. So I'm excited about that because I'm forgiven. And I needed a lot of forgiveness and still do. And so I look forward to sharing that with you midweek. Okay, may you have the rest of the day absolutely great. May the Lord bless you. May the Lord keep you. May the Lord cause his face to shine upon you. May the Lord be gracious to you. May the Lord impact your lives with the light and the power of his love. And may the Lord continue to give you his peace. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with each one of you this day and evermore. Amen. 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 Christ is risen.
He is risen
indeed.
Hallelujah.
And on that note, go in peace to love and to serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen. Thank you. I look forward to being here again in about a month, hopefully, sat in fellowship with you. And thank you to the musicians and the rest of the team. Thank you.